Good morning. Welcome, everyone. We're glad you're here. Hey, just a reminder, we got Sunday school is coming on inside. The door by the office on that side is a good place to start that off. We've got a special timing for youth group today. At 1 p.m., grades 5 to 12 are invited to take part in a bit of pumpkin carving, painting, and with a special message that I think is great, too. So that's at 1 o'clock today, so the 6:30 usual gathering is not happening this time around. Remember that next week we have our contemporary service, our 5 p.m. service. NHB will be back with some fresh music, and our own Sarah Fuller will bring the message. It'll be a great time, and encourage you to be there. Might be our last time to have this part outdoors. Curiously enough, sunset is at 6 p.m., so we kind of get it right in there. So that's very good. That's really, you know, a real positive thing. We're continuing on this week in our series about worldview, and it's based on the book by Greg Laurie by that title. Excellent book. Lots of us are reading up. We have some more copies available for just $5. Carol's got some with her, and also there's some in the office, too. So you can see Carol at any point on that. She's the one with the hat that's about this big right here. Okay, so... So let's see. Grades and Grace continues 5 p.m. on Wednesday. That's been going very well with some good participation. And we're grateful for all the folk taking part in that. This is just a reminder as we get together of the joy it is and the importance it is to stay together. Let's be in prayer about our nation, but let's also just be very open to our need for God as we gather, because, you know, they say we're all in this together, yet we're not really together. But the body of Christ has that power to pray for each other. We have the Holy Spirit at work in each other. So let's pay careful attention to our own personal walk with God today and always, because that will be the resource that helps us continue through as we get the little bit of this lag of, gee, isn't this over yet? It will be. But the strength we need, we'll get day by day from the Lord. We gather to honor him and to worship him. And I'd want to invite Bob now to come and bring our opening call to worship.
Good morning. Psalm 118, 24 through 29. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is good, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Amen.
Thank you, Bob. And we're going to begin our singing with the song, I Love You, Lord. And as we get together, just think about the blessings of God in your life. Think about the people who bring light and hope and joy. Think about those times that God was what you needed and he came through. Think about all the ways you've been blessed, and let's together stand to sing, I love you, Lord.
As this needs to get on.
Yeah, we got you now.
Hello? No.
Not much.
Frank? No? As we get started, one of the people who blesses us is our pastor. And this happens to be Pastor Appreciation Month.
Oh, you see.
And we, on behalf of the deacons, we want to specifically say thank you to you and to Carol for a crazy year this has been. And how you have led us and guided us and prayed with us through it all. So we thank you so much.
Thank
fog clear off the glasses.
Yeah.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Oh, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. Oh, I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. I lift my voice. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to
You know, when we started doing this in the kind of the warmth of the summer, a lot of you sat about where you are now, but it was to be in the shade. Now you're there to sit in the sun. But really, I just noticed that no one wants to sit up close in church, but a pandemic is a pretty good reason for that, too. Grateful to everybody who's shared the concerns. Just a reminder, especially to folk who join us virtually, you know, more and more a real part of our congregation. And just to use prayers to prayer@fccHanson.org, and we can include these here. We're glad that there are joys to share, glad that we can intercede for one another. Also glad for the updates that we get. And thank you again, Jane, for the work you do in maintaining and keeping our prayer list going. But let's keep in prayer for each other. Let's sustain each other. Let's let prayers motivate us. You know, prayer changes things. Sometimes it's because prayer changes us. And that's a beautiful thing. Let's go to God now. Our Heavenly Father, we love you. We lift our voice because of how good you are. Because of your goodness, not just in the good that you do, but the honor of who you are. And that, though we do not deserve you, you love us and call us to walk with you. Lord, I want to thank you for the privilege that Dave McPherson and I had this week to show some love and care for our neighbors at All American Assisted Living, the 20 that gathered there to to hear, to sing, to be reminded of your love, and that it reaches into walls and past walls, even that other ways can't break through. We want to thank you, God, for the good news that Jane's friend Carol received regarding her aneurysms. Pray you continue to hold her in your care, and that she know your love is very near and real. Lord, we give you thanks for the joy of Kathleen having a new job to start. And we pray you be with her tomorrow as it begins virtually, and help her through each day and each of the challenges. We thank you, Lord, that we can bring to you those who need healing. The crowds did that wherever you went, Jesus, and you touched and you healed. So we would bring before you Bonnie Mills, healing in her eye, for both Jane and Marie, who will have knee surgery this week, for Dan facing neck surgery, for Angela, Bruno's mother, needing gallbladder surgery. We ask, Lord, for your healing touch on Jane Fox, Jimmy Steyer's mother, who's had a stroke, that you would raise her up, Lord. Be with Jimmy and all the family caring there. Lord, we also would pray for Kendra and Barbara. They've had death in their family, grief recently, and now they're watching Dad's decline and knowing another time is coming. So, Lord, just as you were tender at the bedside of many, would you have your care be upon these folk, that they would know even in the darkest moments that you walk with them. Lord, please continue to be with our school children, with those who have home insecurity, or homeless, and the folks who are separated. We ask, Lord, your comfort and your strength and your healing on young people who struggle emotionally. And we pray for our nation, Lord. We pray for righteousness at every level of government. We pray for your help to all those who seek you. We pray, Lord, that we and our Christian brothers and sisters throughout our nation would walk in the spirit and life of Jesus, caring deeply and letting all the world know that we are yours because of the love you've placed in our hearts. We pray for our world going through this pandemic and every land. We ask for healing of our land, of our world. We pray for success in the hunt for a vaccine. We pray for effective treatment, and we especially pray for guidance and wisdom for those in positions of public health, that we might all be wise together and show care for our neighbors in how we prevent this from being worse. So have your hand upon us, Lord. We need your mercy. But we thank you that we are not addressing an unknown God, but one who has made himself known in Jesus Christ and who taught us to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. One announcement I forgot to make was that this Tuesday is a trustees meeting, and so we will do that virtually by means of Zoom, and the connections will be sent out shortly. We continue to be grateful that folks support this ministry through just bringing the basket to the basket here, by mailing checks in to 639 High Street in Hanson, 02341. But also folks who go to the FCCHanson.org webpage and give. Very grateful. But I just want to remind us that this act of giving is an act of worship, where we trust God. We trust God to work through us. We trust God to provide for us, and that we honor him in giving, in supporting his work. We're hoping to rerun the video about the special opportunities we have to support the victims of the wildfires out west. The next time we're inside, we'll do that, or we'll do it on the last Sunday of October if we haven't done it by then. I kind of don't want to wish for inside, because I know it's much more comfortable in a lot of ways to be outside together. But thank you to everybody who supports the ministry, that the witness of our Lord can continue from this place and from each of our hearts into each place that God sends us. Let us commit to him our time, talent, and treasure in prayer together. Lord, every good thing is of you. The earth is yours and the fullness thereof. We know that you will supply every one of our needs according to your riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And so as we give financial, time, talent, as we allow ourselves to be interrupted because you have a change of plans for us, Lord, let all of our offering be blessed, consecrated, and multiplied to your purposes. And may each gift given and received be made sacred for your work. For we want to see your kingdom expand. We want to see it come in all its fullness. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. And we're very pleased now to have Walter Engstrom come and offer a song for us.
And Bob Craig. The words from this song are from the book of Isaiah, chapter 55. And they were written 700 years ago, 700 years before Christ gave the Sermon on the Mount, the Beatitudes. There are similarities. And Isaiah speaks of thirsty people and those who have no money, and encourages them to come and to listen, that they may live. Let them come to the water, and let all who have nothing, let them come to the Lord. Without money, without why should you pay the price except for the Lord? And let all who seek, let them come to water, and let all who have nothing, let them come to the Lord. Without money, without strife, why should you spend your life except for the Lord? let all who toil, let them come to the water. And let all who are weary, let them come to the Lord. All who labor without rest, how can your soul find rest except for the Lord? Bring the ones that are laden, bring them all to the Lord. Bring the children without might. Easy the load and light. Come to the Lord. Come to the Lord. Come to the Lord. Come to the
Wonderful, Walter. Bob, thank you so much. I think we need to get Bob the B.B. King rocking chair to play. Lots of people think, if only I had more money, life would be better. I'd be happier. But though we say it a lot, it really is important to remember, money doesn't buy happiness. Example from the book, Juan Rodriguez won the lottery. He won $149 million. Good work if you can get it. He just had just reconciled with his wife. Would you have thought everything was going his way now? Yeah, some of you, you know it's coming. Think again. Once he won, she filed for divorce, demanding half the jackpot, freezing all his money. Money didn't make it better. Winning $149 million only made it worse. Only made it worse. Walter mentioned I'd be reading from the Sermon on the Mount, but I also want to hear our first lesson. Actually, Bob, I'm going to hold off on your lesson. It comes up later in the sermon, so I'm going to hold off on that. We're going to go first to the Sermon on the Mount, kind of a reverse order today. Universally accepted as the great example of the teaching of Jesus of Nazareth. It's found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapters 5-7. You know, if you write a book, they always tell the authors, work really hard on that first sentence. You got to grab the attention. You got to really kind of set the tone, draw the reader in. We need to pay attention to the opening lines of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, picture the setting. Jesus has brought those who are committed to following him up on a mountain away from distractions, so that they could be serious students of the Jesus life, to hear what it is. Let us also be serious students of the Jesus life. I'm going to read to you from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. And there's really three chapters that make up the Sermon on the Mount, but these are the first six verses. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled." If you're trying to understand something important, you need to look at it seriously, deeply, and intently, and you need to notice each aspect. The first component of those verses 3 through 6, the opening of the section known as the Beatitudes, we need to notice how they all start. Blessed. The name Beatitudes itself comes from the Latin word for blessed. So what does blessed mean? We can say that word and, gee, I have been blessed. Does it mean, though, of no practical value, but only some imaginary spiritual value? Does it mean happy? Like, you put on a silly smile on your face even when there's great pain and struggle around you. Or does it mean anything that makes me happy? Well, Jesus lived in the real world. You know, he saw his mother grieve the death of his foster father, Joseph. He saw God's people under the thumb of Rome. If this life didn't matter, the Son of God would not have come to share it with us. Simply by its location in these opening Beatitudes, the word blessed has something profound to say to us. It's clearly the goal of our life. It's what to be sought. And it has something profound to say. The blessedness that Jesus says is attached to these qualities is a happiness independent of our circumstances. God does love us. God does want us to be happy. But he wants to give us a happiness that lasts. A happiness that overcomes the trouble the world can dish out. He wants to give us a happiness that overcomes the troubles the world can dish out. So Jesus shows us how to thrive in this crazy upside-down culture. And the first four Beatitudes that I read, that we're looking at today, concern your relationship with God. We're going to see that. The next four, next week, correspond to your relationship with people. And if that sounds oddly familiar, it's because we saw the Ten Commandments have the same structure. Four about God, and then six of them, 5 through 10, about relationship with people. Just one more way. We see that the Bible in its entirety is one consistent revelation of the ways of God with the human race. You know, the mothers who are hearing me now know that when it's time to wean a baby off of a liquid diet and begin eating solid food, the baby often balks at the idea. But the world could not function if full-grown adults did not have an adult diet. And in the same way, if we are going to be of use to the God who made us, who loves us, and died to save us, we need to be weaned of our attachment to the things of this world. So Jesus begins by motivating us to be throwing away worldly gain. A fuller translation of this first beatitude might be, blessed or happy or receiving the favor of God are the poor, the lowly, the powerless, those lacking in spiritual treasure. For the kingdom of heaven belongs to them. If you realize that you have no right in and of yourself to claim heaven, then you're at least halfway home. Some of you remember the great hymn, Rock of Ages. The author writes, "Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Nothing in myself." Now, is there anything as pathetic as someone who thinks they're really talented at something when they really aren't? The worst place for that to happen would be when we go to God. I've heard people seriously brag that when they get to the gate of heaven, they're going to say, "Do you know who I am? You have to let me in." Let's review. I don't know if God will say to them, "And what universe did you ever create?" Or if he will show the proud person scenes from their life when they treated as trash some of God's precious children. I don't know. God has no need to justify himself. But Holy Scripture assures us that there is no place where pride goes before a fall harder than at the judgment seat. That's why the poor in spirit are blessed. The poor in spirit are people who see themselves as they really are. As we are lost and helpless before God, so they cry out to heaven for mercy and help, and God is there. To be poor in spirit is to recognize that God has what we need so that we can discover how generous he is. He gives us the kingdom to heaven when we recognize our utter need for him. He gives the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is saying, those poor in spirit will have heaven in the future and the rule of Christ and the reign of Christ in the here and now. Now, as unlikely as blessed are the poor in anything, sounds to American ears, the next beatitude is stranger still. Blessed are those who mourn. The New Testament, you probably know, is written in Greek. The Greeks paid attention to emotions. They had 9 words to express grief. And this one is the most severe, reserved for mourning the dead. You know, there's nothing that focuses you to understand what really matters in life and what doesn't, like the death of a loved one. We've been through it. One of the most beautiful prophecies concerning Jesus comes just a little later in the book of Isaiah from where Walter read, or sang, or both. It says, the famous suffering servant passage, it says, "He surely has carried my sorrows." Sometimes when we do an immersion baptism, we sing a song also called "Come to the Water," but it has a line, "I felt every teardrop when in darkness you cried, and I strove to remind you that for those tears I died." It's one way that those who mourn shall be comforted. But there is a deeper way. When we grieve, we realize how deep and terrible human pain can be. And if that brings us to the place where we grieve what we have done to our relationship with God, then humbling ourselves allows him to cleanse us and restore us. "Lord, I am sick in my gut over what the pain I've caused, and I have no excuse. Please, save me by your mercy." And he does. That's where new life starts, where what Switchfoot calls the beautiful letdown. Without mourning over a life separated from the life of God, there will be no blessedness, no true happiness. This life is temporary. Eternity is forever. These Beatitudes together teach us that when we gain heaven's perspective on this life's limitations and proper priorities, God's abundant life can begin. One of the greatest challenges for a couple sharing their life together comes in their finances. I remember one engaged couple that was shocked when I encouraged them to have a common bank account. They had expected they would each have their own money. But I explained that the Christian principle of marriage is that the two shall become one. Common goals, common purposes, common priorities. After all, you show me how you spend your money, and I'll have a pretty good idea about what's important to you. Add to that, show me how you spend your time. What matters to you? Are you building your own kingdom, which will wash away like a sandcastle at the beach? Or do we want to live where God is king, in the kingdom of God? And God offers us the choice. Making the right choice is a matter of priorities. And that's where the next two Beatitudes take us, to our priorities. When we allow God to shape the way we view our world, we're giving him authority over our priorities. So we go to the third one, blessed are the meek. And it's a shame that meekness sounds like weakness. Because somebody weak, by definition, has no strength. But a meek person is doubly strong. For they are strong enough to control their strength. It is power under constraint. Old Testament Joseph's brothers sold him into slavery in Egypt. But he rose to become governor of the empire. When those same brothers, desperate for food, came to buy grain from Joseph, not knowing who he was, just his position, Joseph could have killed them then and there. But he had God's perspective and made God's purposes his priority. He told them, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now taking place, the saving of many lives." Jesus finishes this opening set of Beatitudes by telling us, "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for that hunger shall be satisfied." The Lord is interested in our making progress in real life, because this life matters. So it shouldn't surprise us that there is a progression to these instructions. "Because I have seen myself as I truly am, poor in spirit, and have mourned my condition, I now walk in meekness before God, and that leads to a new hunger and thirst for God himself." I don't know if there's a more insane attitude crawling around in our world than the idea that righteousness doesn't matter. I have heard it, you've seen it too, in this mixed up world, people get mocked for caring about doing the right thing. Somehow we try to hide that sin is sin because it does damage. If you love God, you'll want to love your neighbor. And if you do, you'll want to do what's right. So when we hunger for righteousness, we find that God is eager to be satisfied, and to be satisfying that most important appetite. We're talking about walking the Jesus life, and I want to encourage Bob now as he comes and reads to us from Peter's second letter, that we're going to hear something about a progress and some instructions about how to live out this Jesus life, how we can live into God's abundant life. Come on, Bob.
Second Peter 1:3-11. Just when I think I don't have anything, I'm being told his divine power has given us everything needed for life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Thus he has given us through these things his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may escape from the corruption that is in the world because of lust, and may become participants of the divine nature. For this very reason, you must make every effort to support your faith with goodness, and to goodness with knowledge, and knowledge with self-control, and self-control with endurance, and endurance with godliness, and godliness with mutual affection, and mutual affection with love. For if these things are yours and are increasing among you, they keep you from being ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For anyone who lacks these things is nearsighted and blind, and is forgetful of the cleansing of his past sins. Therefore, brothers and sisters, be all the more eager to confirm your call and election, for if you do this, you will not stumble. For in this way, entry into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ will be richly provided for you. Word of the Lord.
Thanks, Bob. When I realized that this was going that way, it's really, I was glad that we could just bring the Second Peter reading here. You know, we studied First Peter right after the pandemic hit, because Peter has a lot to say there to believers who have come to realize they're just temporary residents on this earth. And one of the ways God uses all circumstances, and using this circumstance, is he reminds us that this life is temporary. In the second letter, though, we find a wonderful explanation about how we can be living into God's abundant life. How do we progress along this Jesus life, this process? Twice we heard Peter describe the blessings that have been granted to us. In the reading, you know, those who have come to the humble stage, reached out to God, and then find that he blesses us. He reminds us that God calls us. Even if we don't know it at the time, God is the first actor in the drama of our faith. We might think we are searching for meaning, but from heaven's perspective, God is wooing you, calling you to him. He wants the best for you. We are bankrupt without God. We're poor in spirit. So our loving God gives us what we need, and that is faith. So we have that relationship. Faith is the essential ingredient to the relationship with God. And that's what God wants with you, is to have that relationship. But he wants to bless you, so he gives us a path to climb where there is greater joy, greater power, greater enjoyment of who God is. And this is a path described in 2 Peter. And I call it a path because it reads like a series of stepping stones. He gives you this, add this, and so on. When we walk on a path, we are avoiding the dangers that lay off of it. Paul Beninato and I, where are you, Paul? We went on, I saw you somewhere. There you are. Okay. We went on a walk together, and there was a part where we had to go on a boardwalk because it was muddy on both sides together. You know, you stay on the path because you have to. St. Peter warns his readers not to stray from God's path, because craving what the world craves leads not to blessing, not to the pleasure it advertises, but to heartache and pain. The better idea, walk the Jesus path. So to avoid that and to find the even better life, Peter urges us to let our faith, that first gift, our love for God, lead us to live for him, lead us to demonstrate moral excellence, a right path. Now, when you have a faulty picture of God, your relationship with him can be messed up. For instance, we call God Heavenly Father. But if you had a dysfunctional dad, you may find it is hard to picture God as your father, or to picture the kind of father God is. The truth is that God is the God who defines fatherhood, through whom all fatherhood is known, the way a dad ought to be. How can we get accurate knowledge about God? Accurate knowledge. Near the end of St. Peter's life, there was this heretical cult that started to rise up we call Gnosticism. The word means the way of knowledge. It claimed to have this secret knowledge that only Jesus, let certain people know. And for a price, it could be yours. But Peter says that as we develop this moral excellence, as you strive to walk in obedience, we find in the practice of it that we gain a more accurate knowledge about God. Walter sang about the bread of heaven that is ours without price. Come to the water. The Lord gives freely. After all, nothing in our hands we bring. Because our desire to live for God helps us to see the surpassing excellence of God, Peter invites us to the next step that leads to self-control. You know, talent is a beautiful thing, but no talent succeeds without applying oneself to it, without further development. Musicians practice hour after hour. Artists, you know, painters, they have 20 useless canvases for every one they sell. An athlete must continually adapt, learn, train. And in your career, you learn to not go off on wild goose chases, not to, chase small money. But you stay focused on what will reap the benefit. But if we do not have help from God, we will not gain the victory that is self-control. They each depend on each other. The accurate knowledge helps us walk the right way that helps us exercise self-control. Now we really start to see the logic of these stepping stones from St. Peter. Many translations describe the next step as patience or long-suffering. But we understand words from how they are used elsewhere and by the context they're being used in that moment. I'm convinced that Peter is encouraging us as we grow in self-control to celebrate how we gain success continuing this upper path because of the endurance that is given us. I think that's the best word here to understand what Peter is saying. He gives us endurance. We'll stay on the path. We'll keep going. We'll make further progress. If you've ever tried to make your path, make progress through overgrown woods, you can understand that exercising self-control to stay on God's path will lead to greater endurance. You'll get further. You'll get more done because you're following his path. I want to follow Jesus. Don't you? There's a worldwide movement in Christian growth called Cursillo. It began in Spain. A weekend retreat is the core event of the movement. And during that time, one of the lessons new members learn about is called piety. What is translated here is godly devotion. Sometimes we shy away from understanding piety as a virtue. You know, we hear somebody say, oh, they're pious or something. We've allowed others to attach it with a lack of concern for others. But Cursillo gives a great definition for piety. The orientation of our life towards God. We recognize how real God's love, how practical his love is. We have that right knowledge about God and are progressing on the path, then godly devotion means we hunger for the things that delight God. The God who says, love me and love your neighbor. We've learned that his ways are best. And I love how this progression ends. We've got two more, but they're really close related. Sometimes people act like Peter and Paul weren't friends, but their lives were intertwined. At the end of this second letter that Bob read to us, Peter identifies Paul's letters as Holy Scripture. He knew it early. And just as St. Paul famously wrote that of the great virtues of faith, hope, and love, the greatest of these is love. Peter's path here culminates with love. Two of the Greek words for love. First, with brotherly love, that mutual affection you heard about. and then godly love. You know, without brotherly love, society can't exist. America, most of us remember, became a kinder place after 9/11, at least for a while. Because we saw how our lives are wrapped up with our neighbors' lives. And I can only hope this pandemic teaches us the same language, because we've lost sight of it again. Think of this. The great commandment, the greatest commandment, is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And we live it out by the second that is like unto it, loving our neighbors as ourselves. Now, in Peter's great path of Christian growth, the next to the last, the penultimate, almost there step, is brotherly love, mutual affection. And then culminates with the godly love, the famous agape. That's the subject of 1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter. If brotherly love has something of the enlightened self-interest in it, you know, if I'm good to my neighbors, they're likely to be good to me. Godly agape love is selfless. God so loved the world that he gave his son. This is how we know what love is. The Christ died for us. Christ shows his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, enemies of God, he died for us. This is making progress in real life. We need leaders. We need to help each other become folk who will sacrifice. You know, leaders like Washington and Lincoln. But even more, we need followers of Jesus like Harriet Tubman, who freed hundreds of slaves, like Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who stood true to the Lord in defiance of a tyrant, like Stanley Mooneyham, the founder of World Vision, whose work and mission saved millions of lives, continues to, from starvation and malnutrition. Each knew that more money wouldn't buy them happiness. These Beatitudes together teach us that when we gain heaven's perspective on this life's limitations and priorities, God's abundant life can begin. Let's pray. Oh Lord, you want to give us the pearl of great price. You want to give us the unimaginable treasure. But our hands are full of trinkets that we cling to. Oh Lord, help us to recognize in and of ourselves we are poor in spirit. So help us to let go, to empty our hands of the trinkets, of the things that we falsely consider to be of value in this world. Let us empty those hands of false value. And with nothing in our hands, we open them up to you for you to give to us what you want, that we may have the joy of life in you, a joy of a life that matters, a life that won't end, a life that will culminate in endless joy. And help us, Lord, as your vessels, to offer that life to those you bring our way. Sustain each one within the sound of my voice. For the challenges they face, they may know that you will satisfy that hunger when we allow it to be shaped by your grace and guidance. Hold us in your care. Help us to walk your path. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you. I'd like to invite you now to stand, and we'll join in a closing hymn in our church hymnal. This is found there, although the page may be cleaner than some of the others, because a lot of folks have told me, never heard this before. That's all right. We're going to get it. Bob's going to play it through once. In your mind, you might kind of hum it along, but we'll play it through and hear it.
To walk as a child of the light, I want to follow Jesus. As ever stars to give light to the world, the star of my life is Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all, the night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart, Lord Jesus. I want to see the brightness of God. I want to look at Jesus. Clear sun of righteousness, shine on my path. And show me the way to the Father. In him there is no darkness at all. The light and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Have run with patience the race, shall know the joy of Jesus. In him there is no darkness at all. The night and the day are both alike. The Lamb is the light of the city of God. Shine in my heart.
As you go now to walk the Jesus way, to live your life in him, receiving that abundant grace he's eager to give, may God go before you, within you, behind you, and beside you. May the love of Christ be the water you drink. May his life be your life. Go in his grace and go glad for Jesus' sake.